248. And this is a great mission with Danielle.
Welcome to the Pursuit of the Perfect Race. I'm Coach Terry Wilson, and with each episode, I bring stories of athletes to you that share their experiences at races in order for you to learn how to have your perfect race. You will hear stories from athletes of all ages, abilities, and races of all distances. So regardless of where you fit in, there's something in there for you. Thanks for spending some time with me today. Now let the pursuit begin.
Campeche, I think the airline, or, you know, the airfare was half of what I had to Cancun. So, in doing so, we ended up having to drive about 1 hour from Cancun over to Campeche. And also, when you get out of you, there's a time that went between Cancun and Campeche, Cancun, an hour and a half, and then, you know, you have to get an hour, I guess. Airbnb, I think it was like 300 bucks a night. was really nice, and maybe I had a special post race.
Right. That's the transition race.
Yeah, that's the transition race. Maybe it start, and she went the Campeche Country Club, which is about, depending on traffic, a 20-minute drive or so away from the finish line or downtown area. But they, the race organizers, did a few things differently this year, not just adjusting the race time, but they also adjusted their T2 is, but then also where the race expo is. This year, instead of having the race expo at the convention center downtown, and T1 at the country club, they just put everything at the country club. So, and then before we went out and did registration at the country club, dropped our bag off our bag off all there, and we didn't have to worry about logistically, it made it a lot easier.
Okay. So, you know, you had to drop your bag off the day before the race, right?
Well, you were allowed actually to bring it the day of the race. It wasn't quite clear in advance if cars were required to drop it off the day before. So, I did just go ahead and bring mine out the day before. It's just kind of one less thing to deal with. And the wind in the day before wasn't ridiculous, so I wasn't concerned about my bike getting blown around or anything sitting out there. I just dropped it off and made sure I let some air out of my tires so it's going to be sitting in the heat.
Okay. Now, I know you said that you got everything made out there, maybe how many keys did y'all get?
I think I know where this question is going. We added one key. But in one clicker to the garage, there was a garage where we could park, which is really kind of cool. It's downtown, but like the walled city in that kind of neighborhood area inside the city, the roads are all cobblestone and they're extraordinarily narrow. There's room for like one car in parallel park and then one car in the drive through. And then, like, an inch away from the ground park to it. And pretty tightly put it, but we had a garage that you park in. Yes, we only had, like, one block key.
Okay. So, go ahead. What about being locked out?
Okay, so there was this one day. My mom was probably, thank you for telling the story. So, last year, when we were in Campeche, she was just that determined to get her hair done because it would be like half the price to get her hair done in Mexico than to get it done back home in Baltimore. And so with this trip, she's like, I want to get my hair done. So she went to the same salon to get her hair done. And the people there remember her, she likes my number. But when she was getting her hair done, I went and got a massage. And then I took a taxi. From the hotel back to our Airbnb, we got to my real life moment. I've forgotten to. Actually, she gave me a clicker to the garage, but she had locked the house. And so I got in through the garage. I couldn't actually get into that house through the door. So I stood there and tried to figure out how I could possibly break into this house. And I managed to scale the side of the building, get in through the door of the balcony.
And this is what, 2 days before the race?
Yes. Probably there's time to recover in case I, came tumbling down.
Yeah, you came tumbling down, okay.
I thought it was maybe not the best idea, but I just really wanted to get inside. So, well, it turned out okay.
Yeah. So, this is the first race of the year. What was your mindset like going into this race before you left this race to go down there?
So, I just kind of wanted to be open to the race, right, and whatever experiences that the race brought to me. And of course, I wanted to go win, and really push myself and kind of see, really test myself and see where I am after a week planned, several weeks of increased training and more work with this training, especially with the swim and all of that. So I had been doing some heat training in preparation for this race, knowing that it was going to be hot. So I eventually prepared myself for that. I don't think I really prepared myself for the winding conditions for the swim. But I kept trying to swim. My whole goal was just to put this on me and not worry so much about who's around me or who's not around me. But focus on what I'm doing, what I'm in control. Because in that way, I know if I focus on that, I'll be steady, more calm, more pleasant, and I'm focused on going as fast as I can possibly go.
Okay. And you had a little bit of an accident the day before the race.
So, the day before the race, we were out at the country club, and this is one thing, just an FYI about logistics of Campeche. The country club has a gated entrance, and limit how many people can drive into the country club. And so as a result, we have to park kind of outside the country club and then walk about 20 minutes into the country club. And so it takes me about a walk up this big hill and then down this big hill. And so when the day before the race, after we had finished registration, I was like cruising, dropping off the bike, and all of that, and we're walking back towards the car. And I didn't really want to look the way we're stabilized or anything. So, this truck driving out of some locals that pick up truck and then I was stopped. And so I was running over there in my flip flops, which was probably a bad idea, and just managed to set my toe on the concrete and kind of slice it open right on the tip of the toe.
So, you sliced just the tip?
To tell you this.
Oh my goodness. So, how big was this? I mean, because I mean,
it was pretty bloody. And I was, I just kind of, when it happened, I just kind of looked at it and I thought, that's really going to suck tomorrow and that's probably going to hurt. Okay.
Because there's still water, which is great.
I thought, snow water might actually help heal it, but it's like when it's on the toe, it's right where the toe would rub in a shoe, a bike shoe, or a run shoe. So,
yeah. So, what did you end up doing to heal this or clean this? Because, the really hard is going to get stitches if you need to. You can't really just clean it a bit, so you need something like your skin, but you can't find it.
Yeah, so my mom went to like all the pharmacies. She went to Walmart. Apparently, new skin doesn't exist in Mexico. But what does exist is clear nail polish. So I took clear nail polish and coated it with that. And then I also had like a 5% lidocaine cream, which I rubbed on it. So the new skin, with clear nail polish kind of helped. And the lidocaine don't kind of took the damage off a little bit. But just, word, just a more word of wisdom. If you put nail polish on your skin on something like a towel, wait till it's done to dry until you push that on it. So I kind of put my sock on. I put my sock on, I thought it was dry, but it wasn't dry, and so when I went to pull the sock off, it kind of tore the whole layer of other skin that actually was protecting it off. And so all of it was parts.
Okay, this is the day before the race. Is this whole situation giving you anxiety?
The whole sock thing happened, like, right before the race.
Oh, even better.
Yeah.
So how was your sleep the night before the race.
Okay. Nutrition was all good. We really liked staying at Airbnb, so we have access to a kitchen. So we could just go to the store and pick up some food. So we had roasted potatoes, some spinach, along with the fresh fish from a local fishmonger, which was amazing. It's like $3 for an entire fish. So we baked the whole thing. So it had been pretty well. And then my rest,
going into it with a 1 p.m. start, you don't have to worry so much. You know, usually up at 3 o'clock in the morning, like with pretty good. I could sleep in a little bit, which is nice. And then also, I didn't get an ambient product this year from Hydration Health. They have a product that I use a lot that's real play and replay. And it's just an electrolyte mix that really helps me stay hydrated. And so it was really important for me to stay up my hydration prior to the race and with the hot race. That's been used a lot going into it.
Okay. So, you get on racing and you get on and want to set up down. What's your racing motivation like before you actually hit down the transition one? And do you have to get like a shuttle over there or run up at all facility?
Yeah, so the shuttle was an option, but we didn't rent the car. So I just drove out there and then we had to park outside the country club. So we ended up just walking in from where we parked, so about a 20-minute walk into the race car. Did the morning routine, was able to get a good night's rest, and get up and had a good breakfast and coffee. And with a later start, I did go ahead and bring some extra food with me just to have to eat between breakfast and race start.
So, when you get down to transition, you get everything ready in your body, get all that kind of stuff, you're putting in the head, 90 to 95 PSI wells, you have some deep wells that you're using for this race. How else are you setting up your transition, and when do you actually pull your slack off, and does that give you any anxiety?
No. I normally do a long warm-up, but I'll go out and run. 15 minutes is super light, followed by some active stretching, some drills, and just a few strides to get the blood flowing. And I usually do that, after I set up my transition area, but because it was so warm outside, I did not have a full warm up that you normally do. I just used that 20 minute walk as part of my warm up. And then after I got my transition,
She's been there also racing down here. Who else do you know, and what's the atmosphere like at this race start?
I raced with a lot of these girls last year, and the start list was really similar to last year's start list, so it was a pretty friendly race start. There's a lot of camaraderie, I feel like, within the women's field. Of course, we're competitors, but at the end of the day, we all want the best for each other, and I feel like it was pretty lighthearted, and we were all just ready to get out there and go to work.
So, the gun goes off for the pro man at 12:55 in the morning, go on Friday at 1 o'clock, they're down. How is this coming to you from the time that the gun goes off for the man?
Yeah, I mean, you see most of the men go out, you need to see the way from the gun having to battle the adverse condition. So, you see that, and you're like, they do the same thing. So you just try to stay as calm as possible and reject what's about to be given to you.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, because you know it was muddy and choppy, and so you just eventually have to prepare for that and know it's not going to be an easy lap swim. Well, you know, it's going to be challenging, and you're going to have to try and get a little scrappy with it and, to show the wind and the winds who's boss, right?
So I think you've obviously struggled to swim for a while now, and you put a lot of work into your swim over the winter. How confident did you feel the race day?
I know that I have put in a lot of work. Yeah, I've been swimming now for about 20 months from when I literally started learning how to actually swim and what a stroke cycle is supposed to look like. It's been challenging to learn how to swim, and I've seen myself progress a lot in the pool. My times have continuously dropped. I've been a bit of yardage over the winter, and so I knew that the work was there for self-improvement in the running situation. And like I said before, my goal for this swim was to really kind of stay in my own space and to be mindful of what I'm doing, other than me, and not compare myself to my position and where I want to feel and all of that.
So the thing goes on for y'all. How does the swim go for you? Describe what the swim water looks like. How does it feel? And what's the atmosphere like in the swim for you? Are you all by yourself? Are you with people on your drafting? What's the best line?
Yeah, so at the start line, we're pretty spread out from at the guide. And so when we started out, we had about, I want to say it was about 200 out in the first turn, really. And at this point, we had kind of a crash wind coming from the wind out. And so I was with the group for about that first 200, and that's kind of like how we started getting disconnected a bit from the group. And at this point, we had maybe 300 to the next turn buoy. And with this, we had the wind kind of on our back and the waves kind of pushing us. But I got never swam in conditions like that. It was pretty negative. And so, kind of feeling the sensations of how the waves would lift you and carry you, and kind of having fun with that, because if you were fighting well, at that point it could push you more towards the shore and get you off course. And the timing was really important. But it was timing was also hard, because at that time you look up and see a wall of water in front of your feet. You just a little bit more to consider what you're going to have in that condition.
So tell me more about this phrase, you're an athlete, figure it out.
I think about halfway through, I realized I was thinking about my form and technique, and I'm like, that's not going to help me right now. I got to the point where it's like, thinking about a situation like this, I don't know how to handle the winnings or whatever. I'm just like, you know what? You're an athlete. Your body knows how to fight. Your mind knows how to fight. Just figure it out. And so that's when I started kind of feeling how the water would move me. And I tried to figure out how to use the water to my advantage and use the waves and so it just kind of like figure out just kind of a little, I don't know if it was a kick in the rear end or what it was. just like stop thinking and just like,
So you get out of the swim and 39 minutes is the change. You're only in a P1 for a minute or all seconds there. Go ahead.
Yeah. That's where about this swim. Apparently, I didn't find this out until like right after the race. That was your face. Okay. You make me nervous sometimes. So I didn't find this out until after the race. But apparently, the swim, the turn really, was the last turn really before you went a really, really long, like really hard stretch, and I drifted in before the pro men's race. And so the pro men, majority of the pro women's field had a shortened course until some of the, I don't know if they were really the other officials that were on the course, noticed that we had drifted, so they pulled it back up to where we're supposed to be in front of about four of us out there. It was just a little disappointing to hear that after the race.
So basically, you and whatever females had a disadvantage over the pro men and over those pro women.
Just a longer course.
Okay.
I understand the question. Right after you mount your bike, you basically start climbing out of the country club. And I normally have my shoes clipped in on my bike, and I could have done that here, but I chose not to, because I remember last year when I had my shoes clipped in my bike, I remember mounting my bike and getting my feet in, but I had to get my feet in and strap down really quickly. I remember I didn't quite get them strapped down as tight as I would have liked, even though when I was climbing, like, you just felt a little looser than I would have liked them to. So this year, I just decided to go ahead and put my shoes on the transition and then mount my bike. So I didn't have to worry about mounting with them while I was climbing.
Okay. So you get out on the bike ride, and how does the first half of the bike go for you?
Pretty good. It's really a technical course because, like I said, you climb and then you have a pretty technical descent, which goes around, it's around about cobblestone. And so you have to be, pretty aware of kind of what's going on in your surroundings. The one thing I did notice was that my heart rate went way high, like way higher than it's been in a while. And I think a lot of that had to do with the really rough swim and then the heat as well.
Right. So, as far as the bike ride goes, how is the atmosphere on the bike course for you? Are you able to see other females? Are you able to spot males? What's this like?
I was catching up to some of the age groupers on the bike that passed me in the swim. And then I also was able to make up some spots amongst the pro women. I had moved up from 11th to 7th on the bike. The bike was really windy. And a few sections, we had a pretty strong headwind, but we also had a nice tailwind at times, so that was nice. Over 50% of the course was flat, and then there were some big climbs on the course, too, when we got out of the highway on the crossing overpass.
by the time the end of this class, right, and that's the biggest problem. And I was really mindful about how much water and liquids I was taking. So I made a plan to make sure I would get in my extra bottle when it wasn't going to be done, so that I could have one to drink, but also have one to my body for my health.
You know, as far as the bike ride goes, we don't know about the course last year, so we're not really going to spend too much time on the bike course, but they did make a few changes, and we talked about that a little bit, didn't we?
Yeah, so we had, there was one road that was under construction last year, which we did not ride about. It was open this year, and it was just basically flat, straight, true time trial road. So we went down that a couple times. There was two loops of that, but we did have some climbs, like I said.
Okay. So whenever you get done with the bike ride, you get to mile, say, 52, 53. In the last year, you had a certain way that you wanted to come in and transition. Has this changed any?
No, I mean, before I get into any transition zone, I do start kind of thinking about dismounting my bike and having a clean transition, kind of walking through my head what the transition will look like from walking my bike, taking my helmet out, putting my shoes on, grabbing my hat, and taking off. So I do try to think about that before I go into the transition zone, so I'm ready for it.
Okay. So how does this transition go for you? And you're in less than 2 minutes.
I was really surprised by my time, because I got off my bike and I felt like that was the first triathlon I had ever done. My legs felt terrible. I don't know if it was, I think it was a combination of a rough swim and then working pretty hard on the bike, but you know, I had my legs working. And then like the wind was like blowing my bike around, and I just felt like I didn't really have all over and crashing hard as I'm running. I'm like I've done before, don't remind me.
And you brought that up, I mean.
I know. But I mean, I got to my spot, got all my stuff out, and then went out for a run. I think I had the second fastest, like G2, which I was really surprised at because I felt like I was moving like a slug.
Wow. So you did it over the course, just got the running course. Versus what it was last year.
The like, course is pretty much the same. It was just two loops of a straight out of that. One thing that did change is we did have a couple laps like inside the walled city, which was cool. You know, like running on cobblestones, and then there was a really electric energy because of all the people out there and music playing, bands, drums. But then think of the restrictions like past the water stations that the cobbles were wet, so you just had to be on the question where you're going because your legs are already pretty tired. So running on cobbles that are wet could be dangerous.
Yeah, this time with your football, you know, did you notice your toe? That was good.
No, I didn't.
That's good.
I think everything was hurting, so.
Everything is hurting, I'm dying. So, if you didn't have to do the run, you're talking probably like it's going to be, what about 3:34 this time?
It was warm.
Yeah, so it's approaching almost 9 degrees outside. The humidity is really high because you're up there on the water. How are you feeling overall? And are you having any mental doubts that you're playing in your head?
Yeah, I felt pretty terrible. I mean, my run time was 15 minutes slower than what I'm capable of doing. I mean, so that's, at some point when I started the run, I literally thought, I don't know how I'm going to do this. Because, like I said, my legs were just, they've been meshed somewhere on the course. But you know what? All you do is you just go one foot in front of the other, you just keep going, you do the best you can, and that's all I did. I didn't want to run faster, I tried to run faster, but the legs, they just didn't have it that day. So I just felt kind of like, you get the liquid. On one day, I didn't take as many gels as I normally do.
I just, my stomach didn't feel right because of the heat, and I just ended up taking Coke on the course, which I don't normally take. It just sounded really good.
So do you think the heat actually changed your perception of the calories that you needed, and because you didn't get the calories that you needed, it impacted your run?
I don't think so. No. I feel like I did a good job of getting the nutrition I needed on the bike, and I feel like that's what's really important to help you also with your run. I was still taking in nutrition. I did have at least 1.5 gels throughout the run. I think I was taking in stuff. I just, like I said, the legs were taking because I don't need help, okay? But I think I felt fine. Just better. I think I had a
So, we know we've talked about this course before. Not really much to add here. How was the baseline experience here?
Oh, man, it was sweet. There was just so many people just cheering you on. Lots of high fives going into the finishing shoot. It was just really a fun city. And I tell you what, I was happy to find the finish line. It was time for a margarita.
Time for a
margarita? Two. Maybe two.
Gosh. So, just to give me some advice that if someone's going to do this course next year, what is they expect and what are some tips for them?
Outside in the heat, so make sure you're hydrating plenty of days in advance. Getting in electrolytes that you need. Be prepared for some rougher water conditions. I think there was a lot of newcomers that didn't finish the race because of the rough water conditions. Right, exactly. And then be prepared for a split transition too, because logistically that can be a little more challenging. So,
yeah, some margaritas, though, got milk and all that fun stuff. Overall, being disappointed, how do you feel about your performance?
Overall, I'm pleased. I think it's a good way to start the season, and I feel like it was a good way to start the season because it's kind of like the first race of the season would be that challenging. It's like if I can finish that, I can do anything. Physically and mentally, I've gotten stronger over the last few months, and I think that the climate is stronger. So, I'll let all of it stop there. It's going to go and keep working on it. I'll just keep working on it.
Okay. Well, being that we're starting off this year again, I'm just going to ask you the same question that I did last year. I'm going to wrap up everything and ask you, what's your definition of a perfect race?
I think it's one where just when you cross the finish line, you get everything that you had. Mentally, that is positive. You're thankful for the experience. Be a race where you PR. Just a race that you give everything that you had, and you're excited and eager to keep moving forward. So, there you go.
Well, Danielle, thank you so much. I'll enjoy this again, and we'll talk in a few days to wrap up the follow-up series.
Thanks for tuning in today. I hope you were able to learn something from today's episode. If you enjoy the show, please take a minute to leave a review on iTunes or share it with a friend. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to see pictures from this athlete's race, learn more about who I am, what I'm doing, or be on the show yourself to share your story, check out my website at CoachTerryWilson.com. Until next time, continue the pursuit.